This is a continuation of our discussion of inference rules. I mentioned in the last video, when we have just the rules of implication, our system is not complete. We also need rules called rules of replacement. Remember, by saying that the system is incomplete, we mean that there are valid inferences for which we have no rules. In other words, there are arguments that we know are valid, but we have no way, using our rules, to get from the premises to the conclusion. So consider an example. If I have the statement A or B, and then I have not B, you can tell that means A, right? Because it's either A or B and it's not B. So it's gotta be A. However, we have no rules in our rules of implication that enable us to get the conclusion A from this. And we do have disjunctive syllogism, which starts off with a disjunction, P or Q. And then the second premise is not P, and that enables us to conclude Q. However, this rule does not apply to the premises that we have on the left here. Notice that in the rule, you have a disjunction P or Q, and then you have the negation of the left disjunct, the left side of the wedge. When it comes to the sentences on the left here, I have a disjunction, then I have a negation of the right side. So the rule of disjunctive syllogism does not enable me to conclude A when I have A or B and then I have not B. Strictly speaking, these arguments are not of the same form. Now, I know that may seem like it's sort of pedantic or something, because it's pretty much the same thing if you say A or B, or if you say B or A, right? As long as you rule out one, you should know the other's true. But remember, part of the exercise here is creating a rule system that is purely syntax-based, so that if you had no idea what the wedge meant, you could still operate within the rule system and get all your conclusions. So if you don't know what the wedge means, and you just have this rule DS that tells you, you know, if you have P wedge Q, and then you have the negation of the left side, and you don't know that that's because wedge means or, you wouldn't be able to conclude that these arguments are essentially the same thing. Again, it's sort of like almost like a programming thing. Imagine if you had to tell a computer which conclusions to draw, and you gave it the rule disjunctive syllogism as written here. Well, the computer wouldn't be able to tell you that it doesn't matter which side of the wedge, you know, the sentence is on, because wedge means or. It's only able to operate on the syntax that you give it. So we need another kind of rule to enable us to get this kind of conclusion. And the kind of principle that seems to be missing comes from the fact that if A or B and B or A are essentially the same, if it's down to one of those two, then either one you rule out, you can get the other one. And so this is how our rules of replacement operate. They are based on the principle that logically equivalent sentences are interchangeable. And so the first rule that we're going to introduce is called commutativity, and it has something to do with exactly the situation above. Commutativity tells us that if you have P or Q, then that is interchangeable with the sentence Q or P. The four dots that I put in the middle, that's actually just two colons in a row, stands for is interchangeable with. So what we're doing here is we're setting up an interchange rule, and the rule tells us anytime you have a wedge sentence, you can switch the side. So if we return to the sentences above, A or B, and then not B, we can't conclude A directly from that, but our commutativity rule tells us that we can take the sentence A or B and replace it with B or A, B wedge A. By the way, I'll just use the abbreviation COM for commutativity, and this is logically equivalent to sentence one. So since we have sentence one, it's fine to write this down as well, since it's logically equivalent. And now that I've done that, I have all the ingredients of my disjunctive syllogism. I have my disjunctive premise, and then I have the negation of the left side of my disjunction, which is exactly what the rule tells me that I need. So I can reference lines 2 and 3 and disjunctive syllogism, and that tells me that I can conclude A, right, which is just as it should be. Now, this is probably not the first time in your life that you've ever heard the term commutativity. You probably discussed commutativity at some point in a math class, and you have a similar principle with mathematical operators, so that if you have, you know, 2 plus 3, that is the same thing as 3 plus 2. That, of course, doesn't apply to all mathematical operators. If you have 2 minus 3, this is not the same thing as 3 minus 2. So some operators are commutative while others are not. And within our system, the wedge is commutative. Also, the dot is commutative. P dot Q is P and Q, so that will be interchangeable with Q dot P, right? Either way, it's just telling you both things are true. Let me introduce another rule that's similar to a rule from math. This is called associativity. And this pertains to a situation where you have a disjunction or a conjunction, one side of which has the same operator. So if we have P or Q in parentheses or R, then that is interchangeable with either P or else Q or R. And at this point, I hope this seems pretty natural. Either way, it means at least one of the three things is true. Associativity also works for our dot operator, because dot means and. So if you have P and Q and also R, that is interchangeable with P and also both Q and R. And both of those just mean that all three things are true. Now, there are a couple features of rules of replacement that make them work differently from the other rules, the rules of implication. And these are more easily demonstrated with the associativity rule. So now I want to take a look at those. The first thing I want to point out is that a rule of replacement is a two-directional rule. You can take a statement of the form on the left and replace it with the corresponding statement of the form on the right, but you can also go in the other direction. So if I have P and also both Q and R, I can replace that with P and Q and also R. It works both ways. The other thing that's different about rules of replacement is that rules of replacement tell you these sentences are absolutely interchangeable with each other. That means you can use a rule of replacement on a sub-sentence of another sentence. So if I've got a sentence like this one, A implies that B and C and also D is true. Well, the sentence in brackets here matches the associativity rule because it fits the form of the right side of associativity for the dot. I can use the associativity rule on just this part of my sentence, and I can replace that with the equivalent on the left side of the associativity rule. Now, I leave the rest of the statement as is. That's still there. The idea is that I'm replacing a sub-sentence of my sentence with something logically equivalent. So the whole sentence will be logically equivalent. So I still have the A implies, and then I replace the consequent of this conditional with something logically equivalent, B and also C and D. So that is an application of the associativity rule. That's something that's quite powerful about these rules of replacement that differs from rules of implication. Remember, when we were dealing with rules of implication, you can only use the rule if the main operator of your sentence matched the main operator in the rule, and you could not use a rule of implication on just part of a line because those were argument form, whereas what we have here is interchange rules for logically equivalent sentences, which counts even when they're a part of a larger sentence. Now that you've seen how rules of replacement work, let's run through a couple more rules of replacement. Distribution is another rule relating to the dot and the wedge, and it deals with a case where you have P and also either Q or R, and it tells us this is equivalent to either P and Q or P and R. This one's a little tougher to process, so here are a couple ways you can think about this. One is visually. If you just look at the P dot part here and think of it this way, the dot distributes over wedge. So the P dot we find repeated on both sides of the wedge when we change it. It's the same way that multiplication distributes over addition in math. Another way you can process this is by thinking of an example. And I like to think of an example of something either really bad or really good. In this case, suppose you get kidnapped by a pirate and you say, what are you going to do with me? The pirate says, well, I'm going to torture you, and then I'm either going to kill you, or I'm going to throw you overboard. That means either you're going to be tortured and killed, or else you're going to be tortured and thrown overboard. And if the pirate really wanted to torture you, he would say it to you that way. I'm either going to torture you and kill you, or I'm going to torture you and throw you overboard. And then you have to figure out you're going to be tortured for sure. So the dot of our system distributes over the wedge, and also something that doesn't happen in math with the multiplication and addition, the wedge distributes over the dot as well. If we have either P or both Q and R, this is equivalent to either P or Q and also either P or R. So again, we have wedge distributing over dot. And you can think of an example to try and process this one too. If the pirate says to you, I'm either going to torture you or I'm going to feed you and send you home, that means that you'll either be tortured or you'll be fed, and also you will either be tortured or you will be sent home. And again, we can go the other direction too. Pirate says, I'm going to make two choices. First choice, I'm either going to torture you or I'm going to feed you. And then the second choice I'm going to make is I'm either going to torture you or I'm going to send you home. And then you can extrapolate from that. Then one of the possibilities is that you will be fed and sent home. So there's distribution. That's certainly a lot of fun. We're going to have a rule for double negation, which says that if you have not P, then that is equivalent to just P. That one's not surprising. We've already looked at cases like that before. Essentially, this tells you if you have two tildes in a row, you can remove them. They sort of cancel out. But also, don't forget, you can go in the other direction. And if you have any sentence whatsoever, you can add two tildes to it. There are cases where you might want to do that. If you had the statement not A or B, and then you also know A, we can't quite do a disjunctive syllogism because we would need the negation of the left side of our wedge statement to do a disjunctive syllogism. But since we have A, we can write down not A by going from right to left in our double negation rule. And that gives us what we need to do a disjunctive syllogism. We need the negation of the left side of our wedge, and here it is. Another rule of replacement is called De Morgan's Laws. It's a two-part rule, and this deals with the relationship between and, or, and not. So it tells us if we have not both P and Q, then that is interchangeable with either not P or not Q. So just think of a case where I give you two boxes, and I say box A and box B, and I say they're not both bombs. So it's not the case that box A and B are both bombs. It's important to notice that I'm not just distributing the tilde here. Tilde doesn't distribute over dot. It doesn't mean that box A is not a bomb and also box B is not a bomb, right? It only means that either box A is not a bomb or box B is not a bomb. Now remember, that includes the possibility that both of them are not bombs, but one of them might be. The second part of De Morgan's law, as you might expect, has to do with the negation of a wedge statement. So if we have it's not the case that either P or Q, this is equivalent to not P and also not Q. So again, just think of a situation where I say, is it the case that one of these boxes is a bomb? And suppose the answer is no, it's not the case that either one of these boxes is a bomb. Then that, of course, means the first one's not a bomb and also the second one is not a bomb. So that's good news. These statements on the bottom are the both not statements. They tell us P and Q are both not true. Whereas the ones on the top are not both. They tell us not both P and Q are true. So remember not to mix them up. The ones on the top are not equivalent to the ones on the bottom, but they are equivalent to each other, and vice versa. Now, that's the first five rules of replacement. Get some practice with those, and we'll also do another quick video running through the next five rules of replacement, and then we'll have them all.